Pete Hill, ex-drag racer, longtime motorcycle rider. It all started when I was about 5 years old. My uncle took me to a parade in Athens, Georgia, and they had motorcycles in that parade, and I thought that was the greatest thing I ever saw in my life. And I said, told my older sisters, I said, that's what I'm going to be when I grow up, a motorcycle rider. Had no idea I really would be, but that was started my love for motorcycles, and I guess that stuck all these years. I'm 80 years old now, and I still love motorcycles. I ride them every day. Started drag racing when I was just a teenager back in the late 40s, of course. Yeah, anytime you've got a motorized vehicle, a teenager is going to find out how fast it'll go and gets his buddies. So we did some unorganized drag racing. Then later in the late 40s, I did some, you know, it's organized, but pretty crude drag racing. And of course, I went in service and everything stopped for a few years. And when I came out, I started back racing and same thing and getting faster motorcycles and working on them more. And things just progressed till probably the early 60s. I built a bike and I raced till like in the 70s and stopped and for a couple of years, and then still built back in 75. I went back on the circuit big time this time and with Top Fuel, and we ran till 94, and I finally hung it up then. I've got the age on me, but we raced in Europe and Australia and Canada and all over the United States. We were 5 times national champion Top Fuel, and lucky enough to have had some recognition and inducted into about 5 Hall of Fames, all the good ones. Drag racing was a lot of fun and a lot of hard work, and I miss it because I miss the people. During my racing career, I had a lot of things that happened, and some of it's fun, some of it's not so much fun, but more interesting things, I guess, is we had a match race up in North Carolina, and Elmer Tritt and Ray Price and several big names, Danny Johnson and Marin Owens was there, and they paired us up. One of the passes was me and Elmer Tritt. And so, you know, match racing, you do big burnouts. So we did a side-by-side big burnout, you know. And I got down that back then, we just turn around and ride back to the line. And I got down, turned around, and Elmer was off his bike and running back towards the starting line. So I just rode back by Elmer to see what was going on. There's a crowd of people down there, and there's a guy laying on the ground and back at the starting line. And Danny Johnson was kneeling down there with him, and they told me to go ahead and make the pass. So I went ahead and made the pass. And I came back to the pits, and Danny Johnson was pitted just beside me. And I got off the bike, and I went over and said, "What happened back there?" And he said, "Well, Elmer, when he was in the top of his burnout, he broke the primary chain. It's a double row, and pieces went back. And this guy from Oklahoma was standing back at the starting line, and a piece of the chain hit a guy in the worst place you can hit a guy." And I said, "God, it hurt him bad." And Danny said, "It killed him." And I said, killed him? How do you know? And he said, told me it did. So things like that happened. I was match racing with Larry McBride in Fayetteville, North Carolina. And it's just me and him. And we did this long burnout, you know, side by side, because it's showboat time. And I got down to turn around, and Larry come by me, you know, idling fast, and like the clutch had locked up, you know. He went on down and turned off, so I turned around and went back to starting line. And there was a big crowd there. There's a guy laying there over there off the side of the drag strip. And God, what happened, you know? And they told me to go ahead and make my pass. I did. Came back and I found out that Larry had never made long burnouts. And his brother always went out and spotted him and pushed him back. Well, he got caught up in the long burnout and run over his brother. I rib him a lot every time I see him about it. Things like that happen, you know. You think it's all serious and everything, but, you know, when you're pushing back or doing burnouts and things happen. My wife, Jackie, always pushed me back most of the time. When we was in certain races, there's a guy that he had a fuel bike, and he always wanted to push me back because after a burnout, he thought Jackie was too much stress for her. And neat guy. But he wanted to push back just a run. And it's kind of funny, you know, putting backwards on a bike. If you get too fast, you'll get going every way but where you want to go. So I just hold the brake a little. And he never caught on to that. And he'd get back and he'd just be exhausted. He couldn't even watch a pass. He'd fall over there just gasping for air because nitro fumes. He always said, how in the world can Jackie push that heavy bike back? And it was years later after I quit racing that I told him I'd hold the brakes on him. You know, most people never knew that Jackie mixed my fuel for me. It was pretty technical because we used the weather stations and all the equipment, a little computer to calculate the air density and everything. But she always mixed it, and we according to our records, you know, and what the air was, and we knew about what to mix. But most people thought I did all that, but it was Jackie. But sometimes during the heat of the race, you know, and get down to the money runs, I never really knew what Jackie was putting in that fuel tank. And sometimes, you know, it was pretty scary to get on that thing. I asked her for a run. I said, what percent you got in this thing? She'd always say, I don't worry about it, just ride the thing. And sometimes it's pretty violent. But luckily, she didn't blow it up and kill me. We used to race out Midwest a lot, and had a lot of friends out there, Tater Gilmore, and a bunch of guys, you know, to run top fuel. But Tater was telling me a story about this guy that raced out of Chicago, typical big city guy, and good guy, I know him. And he said the first time he went over in Iowa and raced those hayseeds over there, that's the way this guy put it, to go and show him how to race. Back then, everybody run iron heads, Forster fuel motors. He said he got over there, and here those guys was, those old farmers and everything, had those fuel motors. Big old heavy brakes on them and everything. He said, well, you guys don't know beans about racing. So he's going to show them how to do it. So first pass down the drag strip, he found out why they had these big brakes on them. It's a thing, drag strip, a real short shutdown. And he said, he was telling these people about this and said, I ran off about 200 or 300 feet in a cornfield. Well, Tater Gilmore from Iowa, he said, he's telling this story, and he said, I told him that he wasn't the city boy, didn't know anything about farming. That wasn't corn, that was sorghum. So this guy's telling this story again to a bunch of people. And he said, I made a blast down through there and found out the drag strip was short, and I ran off in 200 or 300 feet of this scrotum field. So that's something to imagine. But there's a lot of stories like that. I could sit here all day telling them, but mainly what stands out is the winds and the people that I've met over the years. It's a lot of fun, and really enjoyed my career in drag racing. We were in Sturgis, South Dakota for actually the first motorcycle drag race they had in Sturgis. And the drag strip back then was up in Belle Fourche, which is 18 miles out of Sturgis. The promoter, New York promoter, he was putting a race on. And he didn't know that we could draw any people up to Belle Fourche out of Sturgis. He was really worried about getting a crowd. So we took three bikes and went downtown and just pushed them down Main Street. Back then, it was only three blocks that they had bikes. And we pushed them down the three blocks and back up, and the promoter was handing out flyers for the race. And of course, everybody said, fire them up, let's hear them, you know. And fuel whack is not that easy to do. And besides that, it makes a lot of noise, and I didn't know about the ordinances and things. And we're about three quarters of the way up, back up Main Street, Tom Laughlin, the promoter, said, well, that'd be kind of neat to fire one up. And I said, yeah, it would, you know. And he's thinking, you know, drawing people out in drag strip. I'm thinking showboat. So he said, would you? And I said, well, if I wouldn't get in any trouble, I didn't know, you know, I might get arrested or whatever. And he said, well, I'd cover you if anything come up. And I said, yeah, I'd do that. So it was on, you know. We ran back and got sent somebody down to the van on the side street and got my fuel, and we fired it up and did a burnout right there, you know, on Main Street. And of course, the pictures of that's in Sturgis Museum, and it's been in a lot of magazines and things. And there was a cop in the crowd, but they thought it was neat. I kept coasting after I did the burnout because I thought there'd be repercussions for sure. And I went down on a side street where the van was, and it's quiet down there. And I pulled up back of the van, and nobody knew where I went. So I was covering myself, but if I'd been anything, that promoter would have left me high and dry. There's no way. He would have took care of the repercussions. So, but that was a lot of fun. It's when we built the first drag bike, fuel bike, nobody was making any parts back in those days. I had to make everything. And I made the cylinder, some steel cylinders, and with sleeves in them. And I used a Southern Railroad boxcar axle, a piece of the center. They're bigger. And everybody won't know where I got the axle. So I told one interviewer years ago, I said, well, I actually I laid under a boxcar with a hacksaw for about 7 days sawing on that thing. And I almost had it out, and I went back the next night to finish it up, and the doggone boxcar was gone. And I had to start all over again. The guy believed me. Of course, that's not true. I got the material from a scrap metal place. Thank you.